I think for the most part, we want our watches to fit, right? As a member of the IBWC, I have to say that this isn't always easy. There are a lot of watches out there that simply overpower smaller wrists, especially one of the most, if not the most popular type of watch, the divers. And that's why today in this video, I want to show you three really great dive watches, including one bonus watch at the end, that look fantastic on a smaller wrist. So let's get started. Let's first have a look at the Tag Heuer Aquaracer Professional 300, a new aquaracer with a diameter of 36mm, a height of 12mm, and a lug-to-lug of 43mm, because this one features a lot of really cool design details, and it is a great choice for those who are looking for a bit of, you know, more elegance in their dive watches. What immediately stood out to me here is the very consequent application of very angular lines and silhouettes on this watch. A smart choice in my opinion, as I can see how quickly smaller watches can come across as a bit too dainty just due to their size. Same goes for the bracelet. The three-link bracelet is brushed entirely on the upside and polished on the flanks, and it does feel very nice to the touch, so you get this very comfortable wear out of this. The middle links have a very distinct slope, which gives you this illusion of a slimmer middle link, which I really like, because that is not your, you know, another typical flat three-link bracelet like there are so many out there. The highlight here is definitely the clasp with the micro adjustment though. You can use these two pushes on the side to slide the clasp up and down to make it fit perfectly, and I cannot stress this enough. The fit of a bracelet can really make or break a watch, especially for smaller wrists that do tend to fluctuate in size a lot. The 300m water-resistant case continues the angular theme, and we can see some really nice details here, like the polished edge, the fine brushing, or the convexity on the opposite side of the crown to mirror the shape to make the entire case look a lot more symmetrical. The black duo decagonal, which means 12, bezel inlay is a ceramic one with a white scale, but I have to say that I would have preferred a bigger markings here. It twists nicely though, but does have a bit of play, and I really wish it didn't. You could get this in a blue or a black dial, but I really like the contrast the silver dial gives this watch. The design here reminds me of a, you know, calm sea, and thanks to the black borders, the hour markers are easy to spot. For this watch, you also get a date at 6 o'clock with a little Cyclops lens on top, which is definitely needed given the small date. Inside beats an automatic movement Tag Heuer's caliber 5 with a power reserve of about 38 hours, which is based on an ETA 2824.2. According to millenary watches, could also be based on a Sedita SW200, so nothing fancy, but nothing bad either. Overall, this new and smaller Aquaracer with its three colorways offers a variation for most tastes, and for about $2,800, you get a really good looking smaller diver with a great micro adjustment option on the clasp and a non-standard dial that makes this diver a bit more elegant than you would expect. Next up, I have this really beautiful and fresh looking Breitling Super Ocean Automatic 36 that is powered by Breitling's caliber 17 and also is based on an ETA 2824.2, but the date on here has been switched to a 3 o'clock position. I can see this one being a great choice for those who are looking for a less traditional take on divers with Arabic numerals and a lightweight for maximum comfort. As the name gives it away, it has a diameter of 36mm with a thickness of 11.2 and a lug-to-lug of 43.1mm, which is incredibly compact for a diver. Given those dimensions combined with the rubber strap, it makes this one a very lightweight, like I said, and comfortable watch. And I think it would work very well for those whose, you know, wrist bones poking out a bit, you know, just more than average. But you could also get this one on a regular steel bracelet if you want to. It is available in some really bright colors, like a stark white or a bright orange, for example. But given that it is August right now, I thought I will show you this baby blue to brighten up your day. The bezel on top twists nicely and has zero play, which is great. And the matte finishing on it matches everything on the rest of the dial, as you can see. Pretty much everything has a matte finish except for the applied Breitling logo. The hands are matte, the surface is matte, and the border of the hour markers is matte too. And I think it is a very modern approach to dial design, and everything on it just feels very much thought through, which is something I always appreciate on a watch. The only thing I would change though would be the cursive font of the Super Ocean lettering. I think that's just a bit too much, but luckily it isn't too big either. What is also adding to the modern vibe of this watch are definitely the enlarged Arabic numerals, even though this isn't something groundbreakingly new on a watch face, but In combination with this color and the finishing, it feels surprisingly fresh and up to date, I would say. Another really cool detail on this style is the chaptering. That minute track going around is also divided into 5 minute steps, marked with Arabic numerals, which makes accurate setting super easy. But if we are talking about setting the watch, I think it is important to mention that the crown guards on this one are taking their job a bit too seriously, and it is not as easy as it should be to grip the crown and screw it in or back out again. This one costs about $4,600, and though it is technically using the same caliber base as the Tag Heuer, I think the difference in price is more or less justified given the fact that the Breitling definitely feels more high grade compared to the Tag Heuer. I mean, if you feel or think that it's justified, it's totally up to you, but I really like the general directions of the new Breitling releases, and this one is one of them, and I can see how Breitling is really stepping up their game with their watches. So watch number three is definitely a bit of a sleeper when it comes to smaller divers, because most would probably, you know, just dismiss it by reading the specs with its 39.5 millimeter diameter. But let me tell you, this one has a lug to lug of only 45 millimeter, which is even less than my 36 millimeter diameter Rolex OP Candy Pink. And this Planet Ocean works shockingly well on smaller wrists. So those of you who are looking for the compact diving workhorse in this lineup, listen up now. But first up, let me say how shiny this one actually is in person. Though its color scheme might be less out there, especially compared to the other two watches in this video, boy oh boy does it stand out by how sparkly it is. To blame here is Omega's preference for special materials like the mirror polished black dial or the liquid metal ceramic inlay on the bezel. The bezel itself twists with no problem whatsoever. I mean, it is Omega, what do you expect? And clicks into place in the exact spot it is supposed to. I have to confess that I'm usually not the biggest fan of Omega stripes or bracelets, but I have to give it to them on this one. They made this one look really flowing, almost like liquidy. It continues the flow and curves on the case and does show Omega's capability of understanding the importance of silhouettes that do not overpower the entire design. Each link is smoothed out, has no hard edges, and therefore feels more natural instead of some, you know, boring cold piece of 316L steel. They top it off by adding a sturdy clasp with a quick adjustment option, and I think the cherry on top would have been to have the bracelet taper towards the clasp, but I guess I can't have everything, can I? Anyways, let's get back to the dial and take a closer look, because it's definitely worth it. In contrast with the shiny black dial are the bright white hour markers and hands with shiny silver borders and a similar Arabic numeral layout as the Breitling from before. Omega decided to make the date disc black to, what I would guess, not interrupt the overall dial symmetry more than necessary, given the fact that a date on a dive watch isn't the most important complication. And some of you might already know that I do always enjoy a nice bit of color, so the bright orange splashes through the dial add just enough bits of color to make this watch interesting enough and not just, you know, another black dive watch. It is also the only watch with an exhibition case back in this video, and you can see Omega's in-house caliber 8800 working away with a coaxial escapement and a power reserve of about 55 hours, which is also approved by Meta, so it's a certified master chronometer, including a resistance of magnetic fields up to 15,000 gauss. All of this and the fact that this Omega is water resistant up to 600 meter makes this watch the most tool-like in this list, in my opinion. It's definitely the only watch I could see someone actually taking for a dive, but it's also the only one that would not work in a formal situation either, but that's just my take. So if you are looking for a good looking but also a very capable diver that could do the job with a bit of bling but no blitz, you could spend about $7,500 and get this Planet Ocean right here. Right, and I did promise you a bonus watch, and I think some of you might already know what's coming. So here it is, of course, the Tudor Black Bay 58. Though it is a relatively new watch being released in 2019 for the first time, there are already a couple of variations out there, so I think most people would be able to find one that fits their taste. And this one would definitely be the best choice if you want to go for a smaller diver watch that not only looks but feels like the good old days without adding the issues some vintage watches could potentially have. I already did an in-depth review of the 58 and its latest version, so if you want to know everything in detail, you can check out the links in my videos. I will put them in the description box down below for you. But here are the top three things you should know about the Black Bay 58. Number one, no matter which variation you will pick, it will always feel a little bit vintage due to its design. And if you are not into that, you will not enjoy the Black Bay 58. Since it is an homage to Tudor's own dive watches from the late 50s, the Black Bay 58 unites, you know, the trademarks of the old and new Tudor watches. I personally think that it looks incredibly charming, but you really have to be on board with the, you know, snowflake hands, for example. Point number two, it really is one of those watches that make almost every strap work, though I would always recommend getting a Black Bay 58 on a steel bracelet if available. I know that some people aren't fond of the faux rivets on the side, and then there's also the very disappointing lack of quick adjustment on this watch if you're going for the full steel variations of it. But luckily, I have yet to find a strap that did not look good on my Black Bay 58. And I think its versatility is one of its biggest strengths, which makes this watch a candidate for the legendary One Watch Collection watch. And lastly, point number three, I want to point out that though this isn't nearly as kind of a situation like with Rolex watches or Rolex divers, for example, the demand for the Black Bay 58 is still pretty high. So there's a good chance you have more luck finding the right one as the secondary market instead of having to wait for one from your AD. And so here we have it, three small divers and a smaller bonus dive watch that I really like and which I think are a perfect fit for the members of the IBWC. This is obviously not an exhaustive list, but I wanted to make sure that I can include watches that I really enjoy, but also tried on and tested for you so you can see how they would actually look like on smaller wrists like mine. As always, let me know in the comments down below which smaller divers you would recommend and which watches you would like to see next on my channel. If you have enjoyed this video, you can give it a thumbs up. I would really appreciate it. And if you want to see more videos like this, you can subscribe to my channel and I will see you in my next one. Bye!